Open your Bibles, if you would, to Hebrews chapter 10. Hebrews chapter 10, we're going to look at verses 26 through 39 together today. Hebrews chapter 10, verses 26 through 39. Hebrews chapter 10, verse 26. For if we go on sinning willfully, after receiving the knowledge of the truth, there no longer remains a sacrifice for sins, but a certain terrifying expectation of judgment and the fury of a fire which will consume the adversaries. Anyone who has set aside the law of Moses dies on without mercy on the testimony of two or three witnesses. How much severe punishment do you think he will deserve who was trampled underfoot the Son of God, who has regarded as unclean the blood of the covenant by which he was sanctified, and has insulted the Spirit of grace? For we know him who said, "Vengeance is mine, I will repay," and again, "The Lord will judge his people." It is a terrifying thing to fall into the hands of the living God. But remember the former days, when after being enlightened, you endured a great conflict of sufferings, partly by being made a public spectacle through reproaches and tribulations, and partly by becoming sharers with those who were so treated. For you showed sympathy to the prisoners and accepted joyfully the seizure of your property, knowing that you have for yourselves a better possession and an abiding one. Therefore, do not throw away your confidence, which has great reward. For you have a need of endurance, so that when you have done the will of God, you may receive what was promised. For yet in a very little while, he who is coming will come and will not delay. But my righteous one shall live by faith. And if he shrinks back, my soul has no pleasure in him. But we are not of those who shrink back to destruction, but of those who have faith to the preserving of the soul. Let's pray. Lord, we bow our hearts in submission to you this morning as we sit underneath your word. Lord, our desire is to understand it, to leave this place knowing what it means, knowing how we should respond, and responding how we ought to respond so that you are glorified in us. Lord, you know each and every one of us in this room. You know what goes on in our lives. You know what our struggles are. You know where our faith falters. Lord, I pray that you would apply your word graciously to us this morning. I pray that your word, with its warning, with its promises, with its encouragement, would have its intended effect upon us. That you would accomplish what you will to accomplish with this text. Please, Heavenly Father, be merciful to us. Please speak to us with your word. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen. Hold fast to Christ. That's the message of the book of Hebrews in a nutshell. If we summed it up, the application of this book is a call to hold fast to Christ. Don't let go of Christ. Don't stop trusting Christ. From verse 1 of chapter 1 to this point, and even beyond this point, he is urging, he is warning, he is encouraging, he is pleading, he is persuading the listener to hold fast to Christ. Don't turn away from Christ, because Christ alone saves. It is Christ alone that atones for our sin. It is Christ alone that provides eternal, everlasting forgiveness for sin. It is Christ alone who is risen from the dead and who will give us that same inheritance. So we must depend on him. We must continue trusting that his death counts as our death. We must continue relying on his sacrifice to sufficiently satisfy God's justice. We must keep trusting in His perfect record of obedience to count as our perfect record of obedience. To hold fast to Christ means to keep believing, to keep trusting, to keep depending, to keep relying on Christ. But maybe you're sitting here wondering if it's all worth it. Is trusting Jesus worth the cost? In fact, Jesus Himself said to count the cost. Before following Me, count the cost. Make sure it's worth it, because it will cost you to follow Jesus. We live in the midst of a culture very similar to the culture that this book was written into, in which Christians were becoming increasingly unpopular. And Christianity, biblical Christianity in modern America, is becoming increasingly unpopular. People are becoming irritated with biblical Christianity because we do not run with them in excess of their sin. We do not agree with them that these lifestyles are normal and acceptable. We still call sin, sin, and it bothers them. We're going to be referred to as sexual racists and bigots. We're going to be ostracized. We're going to be ignored. We're going to be looked over for promotions. We're going to be fired from our jobs. We're going to be sued. We're going to be imprisoned to follow Jesus. And because of our following after Jesus, it's not going to get easier to be a Christian in America. It's going to get harder to be a Christian in America. And the question you have to ask yourself is, Jesus worth it? Is it worth the cost? Because it will cost you to follow Christ, to trust Christ, to obey Christ. Because this culture has little time for biblical ethics, for biblical morality, for biblical exclusivity, for our refusal to participate in their evil. So the question is, when it gets difficult, and it will you follow Christ? You need to count the cost now. But maybe you're asking the question, why? Why should I follow Christ? Is it really worth it? Or maybe that's not your question. Maybe your question, you are convinced that following Christ is the right thing to do, but you are uncertain of how to do it in the midst of the difficulty. You want desperately to keep trusting Jesus, but it seems like your world is crumbling around you. It seems like one more straw is going to break the back, so to speak. If one more thing goes wrong, I'm going to lose my mind. And you may be asking, Pastor, I don't know how much longer I can hang on. My fingers are slipping. My hands are growing sweaty and slippery. I can't keep holding on to Jesus. I want to. How, when it's so hard, do I keep holding on? Maybe that's not your question either. Maybe your question is, to what end do I hold fast to Christ? What is the goal here? Why? What are we doing this for? What's the end game? Why are we holding Christ? What are we hoping to accomplish by holding fast to Christ? I mean, in the midst of a culture of Christianity which preaches very popularly that if you have enough faith, you don't have to struggle in sickness. If you have enough faith, you can have whatever material possessions you want, because God wants you to be blessed. God wants to bless you, and the only thing keeping Him from blessing your socks off is your lack of faith. Speak that word of faith and make it happen. Suffering is not the will of God. No, the will of God is your affluence and your health and well-being. And so you look at your suffering and you think, what's the goal here? Is not the goal to have the best life now? You're saying it's something else, something that's worth suffering and losing the best life now and having a pretty difficult life now? This passage of Scripture answers those three questions. If you're asking those three questions, this passage of Scripture is for you. In fact, this Scripture, Hebrews 10, 26 through 39, provides us with three answers to help us hold fast to Christ. So let's explore the text and get some answers. So let's begin with the first question. Why should we hold fast to Christ? Why should we keep trusting Jesus? Look at verse 26. For if we go on sinning willfully after receiving the knowledge of the truth, there no longer remains a sacrifice for sins, but a certain terrifying expectation of judgment. In the fury of a fire which will consume the adversaries, anyone who has set aside the law of Moses dies without mercy on the testimony of two or three witnesses. How much severe punishment do you think he will deserve who has trampled underfoot the Son of God and has regarded as unclean the blood of the covenant by which he was sanctified and has insulted the Spirit of grace? For we know him who said, vengeance is mine and I will repay, and again the Lord will judge his people. It's a terrifying thing to fall into the hands of the living God. Why should you hold fast to Christ? Why should you keep trusting Jesus so that you don't perish? So that you don't find yourself in the hands of an angry God who is omnipotent in strength, who can do whatever he wants to do, and there's nothing you can do to stay his hand. Remember the context of this text. In verses 22 and following, he gives us these imperatives to draw near to God, to hold fast the confession of our faith, to urge one another to love and good deeds. He's calling us to hold fast, to keep trusting in Jesus, to draw near unto God, to cling to Christ, and to help one another cling to Christ. And he gives us the answer. Why should we do that? Verse 26, for if we go on sinning willfully, after receiving the knowledge of the truth, after knowing that God sent Jesus into the world to make a better sacrifice, to inaugurate a better covenant, to give us a better inheritance, if we go on willfully sinning, after that knowledge has been received, there no longer remains a sacrifice for sins. Why should you avoid having a picnic in the middle yellow lines of Interstate 70 during rush hour? So that you don't die. It's the same logic. Why should you keep holding fast to Christ? Because Christ alone saves. There is no other sacrifice for sins but Christ. There's no other way your sins are removed, other way that your guilt is cleansed, other than Christ. He's it. There's no other name given among men by which we must be saved other than Christ. And if you do not keep trusting Christ, you are going to perish. Why should you hold fast to Christ? Because if you go on willfully sinning after receiving the knowledge of the gospel, there's only a certain expectation of judgment. What is he talking about? What is this willful sinning that he is referring to? There are some who believe that this means that if I sin after I am converted, if I disobey God after I'm converted, then I lose my salvation and I have to get saved again. It's a terrible way to live. It's a horrific way to live. For one, that's not what the text says. The idea that you get saved again doesn't happen. If what he is saying is, if you sin after conversion, there's no more sacrifice, you don't get saved again. He says there's no more sacrifice for sins. In chapter 6, he says the same thing. If we have fallen away, there is no repentance left, because that would require Jesus to be sacrificed all over again. The point of Hebrews is, if you walk away from Jesus, if you fall away from Jesus, if you turn away from Jesus, you're lost forever. There's none of this get saved, lose your salvation, get saved again, lose your salvation, get saved again, lose your salvation. It's not biblical. If you lose it, it's gone. Is that what he's saying? What is this willful sin? If I don't, I have to not sin again? How many of you have sinned since your conversion? Does it frighten you? Is that what he's saying? No. The whole book, he's talked about how Jesus made purification of sins, how Jesus secured eternal redemption, how Jesus accomplished everlasting forgiveness of sins, that his sacrifice wiped the slate clean. His sacrifice was once for all past, present, future sins. They're all paid for in Christ. So what is he talking about here? Maybe it's just this high-handed sin, this idea that I know that's a sin and I don't, I just choose to do it anyway with arrogance. That's no different than what we just talked about before. All of our sin, we know it's wrong. In that sense, all of it's high-handed. How many of you sin and you're like, oh, I didn't realize it was a sin? No, we sin and we know it's a sin. So what's he talking about? I think he's talking about the same thing he's been talking about the whole book. Look at chapter 2. Look at chapter 2, verse 1. For this reason, we must pay much closer attention to what we have heard, lest we drift away from it. For if the word spoken through angels proved unalterable, and every transgression and disobedience received a just recompense, how shall we escape if we neglect so great a salvation? After it was first spoken through the Lord, it was confirmed to us by those who heard. If we neglect Christ, if we turn from Christ, if we abandon Christ as our hope, there is no hope for us. There is no other salvation. There's no other sacrifice for sins. There's no other means of forgiveness. There's no other way that your guilt is removed. There's no other way that consciousness of sins is cleansed. Without Christ, there's no hope. There's no hope without Christ. And the people that he is writing to are in danger of abandoning Jesus to put themselves under the theology of Judaism again in order to insulate and protect themselves from the persecution. And we are tempted to the same thing because people are going to mock us. People are going to ostracize us. People are going to sue us and fine us and imprison us because of our obedience and faithfulness to Christ. And we're going to be tempted to pull back away from those commitments and from those acts of obedience so that we're not persecuted. And he is saying, if you abandon Christ because it costs you something, because you don't want to be persecuted in order to insulate yourself and give yourself safety, you're turning away from the only one who saves. If we neglect Christ, there is no salvation. Look at chapter 3, verse 12. Take care, brethren, lest there should be in any one of you an evil, unbelieving heart in falling away from the living God. But encourage one another day after day, as long as it is still called today, lest any one of you be hardened by the deceitfulness of sin. For we have become partakers of Christ if we hold fast the beginning of our assurance firm until the end. We have become partakers of Christ if we hold fast. We must keep believing. True believers keep believing. You've heard the parable Jesus told of the four soils. There's four kinds of dirt. There's four kinds of listeners. The question is, what kind of dirt are you? There is the hard packed dirt. That when the gospel falls upon it, when the word of God hits upon it, it doesn't sink into the soil. It just bounces off and the birds come and scoop it away. This is the oblivious person. They don't hear it. They don't respond to it. They don't care about it. That person will face judgment. There's the shallow hearer,
the Word of God penetrates their hearts. And they get all excited about Jesus and church, and they come and they're excited, they're involved, they're active. They give off the appearance of a growing, excited, vibrant Christian, but they don't produce fruit. And when the storms of difficulty come, when life gets hard, when it costs them something to trust Jesus, they stop trusting Jesus. They fall away. The person was not a believer. The fact that they went out from us proves they were never really of us, 1 John says. Then there is the distracted soil. The Word of God falls into this soil and a plant springs up, but there's so many other plants and weeds in that soil that those choke out the Word so that it doesn't produce any fruit. There's so many cares. There's so many loves of the world. There's so many pursuits for possessions and relationships and activities of the world. Your life is so full of the pursuits of the world that you have no time to love God. You don't produce fruit and you fall away. You were never saved to begin with either. There's only one soil that's saved. It's the soil that grows and produces fruit, that keeps produce fruit, that endures in faith. This is what the author of Hebrews is talking about. Beware of that evil, unbelieving heart lurking in you undetected, where you are self-deceived, thinking that you are a believer, but you're not a believer because you are not trusting Jesus. He's warning us that if we fall away from Jesus, there's no other hope, there's no other salvation. Look at what he says in chapter 6, verse 4. In the case of those who have been once enlightened and have tasted of the heavenly gift and have been made partakers of the Holy Spirit and have tasted the good word of God and the powers of the age to come and then have fallen away, it is impossible to renew them again to repentance, since they again crucify themselves to the Son of God and put him to open shame. If a believer falls from Jesus, if a believer turns away from Jesus, if a believer repudiates Jesus and says, I'm not going to trust Jesus anymore, I'm going to look over here for salvation, I'm going to come this way to protect myself. If a believer walks away from Jesus, there's no more repentance there for that person. It's saying the same thing in Hebrews 10. For the one who goes on sinning willfully, for the one who turns from Christ knowingly, and all that's left is judgment. What awaits the sinner who rejects Christ and the payment of Christ for sin? All that awaits is a certain terrifying expectation of judgment. What awaits a man who jumps out of an airplane who's abandoned his parachute? A free fall of certain terrifying expectation of death. You don't die right away. You fall for a while and then you die. But you know you're going to die. The person who lays aside the parachute of Christ leaps out into the void. The only thing that awaits is the certain terrifying realization of judgment. God's judgment awaits the unbelieving. If you don't keep trusting Jesus, judgment awaits. That's what he's saying. That's the point that he is making. Do you remember the story of the wilderness generation that came out of Egypt? They saw God decimate the Egyptians. They saw the gods of Egypt fall as the Lord marched in glory through that country and just utterly destroyed the power, the superpower of the world. He brought out the nation of Israel. He brought them to the Red Sea. The army of Egypt chased after them. The Lord parted the Red Sea, sent Israel through, and then collapsed the walls of water, smashing and destroying the entire army of Egypt. This people who witnessed all of those acts of God, they come to the place called Kadesh Barnea just a few weeks later. And they're standing there at the southern border of Israel. And Moses sends 12 spies into the land to check out the land, to see which way we should go and how we should take the land. And they come back. And 10 of the 12 spies say, "We can't do it. The land is good. It's whatever, it's what we've been told, but we can't do it. There's giants in the land. The cities are walled up to the heavens. There's no way we can possibly take this land. And Joshua and Caleb, the other two spies, they're just looking at one another like, what? Have you people lost your minds? Have you forgotten what God did to the Egyptians? How can you say these things? But the nation as a whole believed the ten. And they began to mourn and wail and cry and say, we should just go back to Egypt. It's better in Egypt. They didn't believe that God would give them the land. They didn't believe that God would protect them. They didn't believe that God would safely move them into His promised rest. Their hearts didn't believe. And because they didn't believe, they didn't obey. And God said, enough. And the entire generation, 20 years old and up, died in the wilderness. And the next generation went in and took the land. For the next 40 years, the nation of Israel was a wandering funeral march as hundreds of people died every day until that entire generation died because of their unbelief, because of their refusal to keep believing God. And the author of Hebrews is drawing from that story. He talks about it in chapter 4. And he's drawing from that story. He's saying, don't harden your hearts like them. Beware of the deceitfulness of sin. Beware of that lurking, unbelieving heart in any one of you. Keep believing in Jesus. Keep trusting in Jesus. And you will find yourself in the promised rest of glory. It may cost you your life. It may cost you your possessions, but it's worth it. Keep believing in Jesus. And he's warning them, if you don't keep trusting Jesus, you are falling without a parachute. The only thing that awaits you is God's judgment. A certain, terrifying expectation of judgment. A judgment that is just. A judgment that is punishment for sin. A judgment that is passionate. The fury of a fire that consumes his adversaries. We have a picture of God in our minds that is much like this grandfather figure sitting in heaven, rocking in his rocking chair, not too concerned about sin, wanting his people to do the right thing, but at the end of the day, patting them on the head and saying, I understand, kids will be kids. We have this vision of God that He's all love and all grace and all kindness and all compassion. And those things are true about God, but if you don't understand that God is a God of wrath as well, a God of righteousness and holiness who will judge unbelievers, you don't understand who God is. Our God is a God who gets angry when people scorn His Son and spit on His blood. As if it means nothing. He is a consuming fire. He is a God who will enact vengeance upon His enemies. He is a God who is terrifying in that sense. And this text ought to make us tremble. It's good to tremble before the Almighty King of Heaven. You don't believe me? I mean, he says in verse 28, anyone who set aside the law of Moses dies without mercy on the testimony of two or three witnesses. How much severe punishment do you think he will deserve who has trampled underfoot the Son of God, who has regarded as unclean the blood of the covenant by which he was sanctified and has insulted the Spirit of grace? If you don't think God will judge unbelief in our hearts, he did it then. When this generation disobeyed God, they disregarded the commands of God, they set aside Moses' commands, they died in the wilderness. And if you trample on the blood of Jesus, if you treat Jesus as worthless and good for nothing, he's just street garbage, not valuable for anything, not saving, You just throw him out and throw him away. If you treat his blood as if it doesn't accomplish forgiveness of sins, it is unclean, it's useless, it's invaluable. If you insult the Spirit of grace who opened your eyes and showed you your sin, who drew your heart out of its darkness into the light of God, who transformed you from a child of Satan into a child of God, if you insult that Spirit by saying, I want nothing to do with Jesus, do not be deceived. God will judge. And he will judge with a furious fire. It says the Lord will judge his people. And it is a terrifying thing to fall into the hands of the living God, to fall into the hands of the omnipotent creator of the universe, to whom no one is stronger or more powerful. The author of Hebrews is warning us so that we don't do that. Keep trusting Jesus. Why? Because if you don't, you perish. If you don't keep trusting Jesus, you demonstrate you were never saved to begin with. You see, as Southern Baptists, we have a false doctrine that has been cooked up. This idea that as a child you can say the sinner's prayer and you become a member of the church and you're guaranteed heaven regardless of what happens the rest of your life. That's a lie. It's a lie from the pit of hell. What the Bible says is those who endure until the end are saved. Those who keep believing in Jesus to the end, they are truly saved. Because they're the ones that produce the fruit. Others that fall away because of trials, or others that fall away because they love the world more than Jesus, they're not saved. They may look saved, they may appear saved, but they're not saved. Why should you keep trusting Jesus? Because you will perish if you don't. But maybe that's not your question. Maybe your question is how? How do I hold on to Jesus? I want to, but my life is falling apart, and I don't think I can hang on much longer, Pastor. I don't know how to keep trusting when it's so hard. Look at what he says in verse 32. But remember the former days when, after being enlightened, you endured great conflict of sufferings, partly by being made a public spectacle through reproaches and tribulations, and partly by becoming sharers with those who were so treated. For you showed sympathy to the prisoners and accepted joyfully the seizure of your property, knowing that you have for yourselves a better possession and an abiding one. Hold fast to Christ by remembering your previous endurance. What was it that enabled you to endure before? You see, the church that he is writing to, they had already experienced persecution. Most likely it was when the Jews were all expelled from Rome because of the controversy and the riots around between the Jews and the Christians about who Jesus was in AD 49. They were eventually allowed to come back into Rome, but a lot of them were expelled from the city. Their possessions were taken. Some of them were imprisoned. The things that they owned in this life were stripped away from them. And he says, you endured this joyfully. You accepted this joyfully. Why? Because you knew something. You knew you have a better possession, an abiding possession. See, what enabled them to endure was the knowledge of the future promises of God. Not only is the author warning us about the danger of unbelief, he is urging us forward with the promise of glory. We look forward to the reward. We look forward to that inheritance that is ours in Christ. You can strip away everything in this life, and we can accept it with joy. Why? Because we know something better is ours, something that can't be taken away. Take away my home. That's okay. We have a home in New Jerusalem that makes this home look like a mud hovel on the side of a sewage ditch. Take away my health. That's okay, because in New Jerusalem, our bodies will be incorruptible and incapable of getting sick ever again. Take away my money. That's okay, because I'm a child of the King of the universe who gives to me all that I need. Take away my family. It's okay, because we will be regathered to him in the great day of the resurrection, never to be separated ever again. Take away my possessions. I have an inheritance that doesn't decay, rot, or fade away. Take away my job. It's okay. We have a mission granted to us from the King of Glory who supplies all of our needs. Take away our reputation. It's all right, because we are loved by the glorious King of Heaven. Take away our life. It's okay, because we're going to get up out of the dirt in resurrection and live for glory and ever and ever and ever. They can't take away anything that the Lord doesn't supply in wondrous bounty more and for eternity, never to be stripped away. This is what Paul said, for me to live is Christ and to die is gain. The knowledge of New Jerusalem, the knowledge of resurrection, the knowledge of the hope of heaven is what enables us and empowers us to keep believing in Jesus even when it's hard. This is what motivates them. This is what motivated Jesus. Look at chapter 12, verse 1 and 2. Therefore, since we have so great a cloud of witnesses surrounding us, let us also lay aside every encumbrance and the sin which so easily entangles us, and let us run with endurance the race that is set before us, fixing our eyes on Jesus, the author and perfecter of our faith, who, for the joy set before him, endured the cross, despising the shame, and sat down at the right hand of the throne of God. How is it that Jesus endured the agony of hell on the cross? By looking at the joy set before him. Looking at the joy set before him, knowing that he would receive the inheritance, he endured the cross. It's the same thing we find in Hebrews chapter 11. Over and over and over. Let me just give you one example. By faith, Moses, when he had grown up, refused to be called the son of Pharaoh's daughter, choosing rather to endure the ill treatment of the people of God than to enjoy the passing pleasures of sin. Considering the reproach of Christ greater riches than the treasures of Egypt, for he was looking to the reward. How is it that Moses was able to identify himself with the people of God and suffer alongside the people of God and suffer the reproach of Christ? When he could have had all of the pleasures of Egypt, all of the sinful pleasures of this world, he gave it all up to suffer alongside the people of God. Why would he do that? Because he was looking for the reward. We are called to endure in the midst of a hostile culture, in the midst of an anti-Christian culture. And you are going to have to make a decision. Are you going to keep believing in Jesus? Are you going to keep trusting in Jesus? Be warned, if you don't, you will perish. But if you keep believing in Jesus, you do so by looking to the reward. Are you struggling? Then take some time and read Daniel, and read Revelation, and read 2 Thessalonians. Jesus wins. He wins. And he sets everything right. And he wipes away our tears. He resurrects our bodies. He places us in paradise. Brothers and sisters, we endure by setting our eyes on the glorious golden streets of New Jerusalem, looking into the green hills of Jesus' country, and looking at the glittering crystal sea of heaven. There the sun never sets, and there the chill of death is not known. Brothers and sisters, look to that country and find resource to endure. And to the end. You see, that's really the answer to the third question as well. To what end? In verse 35, he goes on. Women, in verse 35 of chapter 10, therefore, do not throw away your confidence. Do not throw away Christ, which has great reward. Keep hold of Christ. Trust Christ. For you have need of endurance, so that when you have done the will of God, you may receive what was promised. The endurance is what brings you into the land of promise. Why is it that the Israelites didn't enter into the land of promise? Because they didn't believe. And because they didn't believe, they didn't obey, and thus they didn't enter. Those who believed entered. Those who believe all the way into the entering are the ones who actually enter. Those who stop believing stop pressing forward. They stop obeying and they don't enter. To what end? What's the goal here? The goal is heaven. You keep trusting all the way to glory. Don't throw away Christ because it's hard. Keep trusting because you need that endurance to enter in and to receive the promise. See, Jesus is coming, he says in verse 37. In a little while he is coming and he will not delay. And it is the righteous who live by faith. If we shrink back, if we pull back, the Lord has no pleasure in us. He says in verse 39, but we are not those who shrink back to destruction, but those who have faith to the preserving of our soul. Do you have faith to the preserving of your soul? Are you trusting Jesus? I want to read a few verses in Revelation and we'll be done. Look at Revelation 2. You have the messages to the seven churches, and in each message, he concludes with the similar statement. In verse 7, he says, to him who overcomes, to him who conquers, to him who endures, to him who keeps on believing, I will grant to eat at the tree of life, which is in the paradise of God. Who is it that gets to eat in the tree of life? It is the one who keeps believing. The one who doesn't keep believing, the one who doesn't overcome, they don't get access to the tree of life. Verse 11, he who overcomes shall not be hurt by the second death. We know from the end of Revelation, the second death is the lake of fire. It's hell. It's only those who keep believing who are not touched by the second death. In verse 17, to him who overcomes, to him I will give some of the hidden manna, the bread of life. I will give him a white stone and a new name written on the stone which no one knows, but he who receives it will be identified with the Lamb of God. But to those who don't overcome, who don't keep believing, they will not. Verse 26, and he who overcomes, and he who keeps my deeds until the end, to him I will give authority over the nations. Who is it that inherits the earth? The meek. Who are the meek? It is those who keep believing in Jesus. And because they keep believing in Jesus, they keep obeying the words of Jesus. In verse 5 of chapter 3, he says, he who overcomes shall thus be clothed in white garments, and I will not erase his name from the book of life, and I will confess his name before my Father and before his angels. To have our names permanently etched in the book of life, as etched upon a stone, we must keep believing in Christ. Verse 12, he who overcomes, I will make him a pillar in the temple of my God, and he will not go out from it anymore. I will write upon him the name of my God and the name of the city of my God and the new Jerusalem, which comes down out of heaven from my God and my new name. To be a part of the people of God, the dwelling place of God, we must keep believing in Jesus. In verse 21, finally, he says, he who overcomes, I will grant to him to sit down with me on my throne as I also overcame and sat down with my Father on his throne. Jesus overcame by faith. We must overcome by faith. We must keep trusting Jesus. We are not those who shrink back. We are those who endure unto the end. The scripture has answered our three questions. Why do we need to trust Jesus? Why do we need to keep holding fast to Jesus? Because if we don't, we perish. If we stop trusting Jesus, there's no other sacrifice for sins. There's no other forgiveness. There's no other way. There's no other hope. Jesus alone saves. Trust Jesus. How? By looking to the reward. Looking to the inheritance that is surely ours because of Christ. And that's the goal. We must endure until the end. Are you trusting in Jesus? Don't sit there and fritter away this moment thinking, I think I trusted this at this time. I'm not sure. Do you trust him now? Are you trusting him now? The one who is truly saved is trusting Jesus now and will keep trusting Jesus into eternity. If you are not trusting Jesus, then come and talk with me during the invitation. Talk to one of us after the service. Let us help you trust in Christ. Let us help you pray and look to Christ. Do not harden your hearts. For those of you who are trusting in Jesus, but you're struggling because it's hard, look to the reward. Keep your eyes fixed on the glittering glory of New Jerusalem, on the green hills of Jesus' country, and know that that day will come, and it's going to be good. You can endure. Don't give up. Don't quit. Let's pray.